But when I hung out at the VA, there was a head nurse on C2. You would ask her how she was doing. Good morning. Her reply was always, "I'm speaking and blessed." I hope this morning that everyone here can say that they are speaking and blessed. From Jeremiah, chapter 12, verse 3. "But you, O Lord, know me. You have seen me, and you have tested my heart towards you." 58 years ago, I gave my heart and soul to the Lord. 52 years ago, I gave my heart to Alice. Shortly after that, two sons, two daughters-in-law, and four grandkids. And each one of them has one of my hearts. What is a heart? And how many do I have? You forgive me while I'm mixing up. I thought I'd get up close so I could see it. My 1976 edition of Webster's gives seven definitions for the word heart. I'm going to give you three. A hollow muscular organ that by rhythmic contractions keeps up the circulation of the blood in the body. Number two, the whole personality. Also, the emotional or moral as distinguished from the intellectual nature. So you ever think about your heart? Can you make the emotional and moral part of it? One's innermost being. In the Hebrew, there are 11 words for heart, and in the Greek, there are three. Jesus tells us in the Gospel of Matthew to love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. The Bible says a lot about the heart. I'm going to share 12 things with you that it says about the heart. And there's a lot more. The heart is repentant, deceitful, loves evil, is a fountain of evil, is full of iniquity, is hollow, it's upright, it's clean, it's perfect, it's wise, it's proud, and it's pure. In the Beatitudes, Jesus tells us, "Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God." This is a cause of a clean and a holy heart. Jesus says, without a pure heart, you will not see God. No one can see God without a pure heart. The problem is that none of us has a pure heart. Proverbs 29. "Who can say, I have made my heart clean and I am pure from sin?" Christ is the only one who cleanses our heart and gives us peace. Proverbs 4:23. "Watch your heart with all diligence, for out of it springs the issue of life." Who and what have you given your heart to? If you're here and you haven't given your heart and soul to the Lord Jesus Christ, before you leave here this morning, I urge you, as our ushers come forward to receive our tithes and offerings, let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for the day. Thank you for the blessings you've given us. Thank you for the privilege we have to be in God's house. place I'd rather be.
I saw you a bad guy.
You see that?
I just saw you with my neighbor.
Father, I do pray this with anyone here at all. There's no need for you to stay in their lives if you be child. That you bring this picture. Father, we ask now that you bless this offering. May it be in your wives and your glorifying in your name.
Thank you. I've only preached out of this two times. Today's my third.
Stay back.
I think some people shy away from it because of the debate on if it was wine or juice. That's not what I'm preaching on this morning. But I've been studying and I got a hold of one of my rabbi brothers. That's always a lesson. And they told me exactly what it was on that day and that time. And there's a whole lot of meat in this chapter. And I just pray that God will help me get everything out that He's shown me and given me. You pray for us this morning. How many is glad to be saved?
Amen.
If you're saved, raise your right hand. If you know it, raise your left. If you don't know your right hand, your left, just wave. The Bible says in John 2, at verse 1, and the third day, there was a marriage in Cana of Galilee, and the mother of Jesus was there. And both Jesus was called and his disciples to the marriage. And when they wanted wine, the mother of Jesus said unto him, they have no wine. And Jesus said unto her, woman, what have I to do with thee? Mine hour is not yet come. And his mother said unto the servants, whatsoever he saith unto you, do it. Verse number 6 says, and there were set there 6 water pots of stone, after the manner of the purifying of the Jews, containing 2 or 3 firkins apiece. And Jesus saith unto them, fill the water pots with water, and they filled them up to the brim. And he saith unto them, draw out now, and bear to the governor of the feast. And they bear it. And when the ruler of the feast had tasted the water that was made wine, he knew not whence it was, but the servants which drew the water knew. And the governor of the feast called the bridegroom, and saith unto him, every man at the beginning doth set forth good wine, and when men have well drunk, then that which is worse. But thou hast kept the good wine until now. Lord, I pray that you'd help us. We'll give you glory and praise for what's accomplished in this place and in the hearts of your people. Save lost souls, if there be one here today. Encourage the saints of God. Bring back to my remembrance the things that I studied. Help me say all that you want me to say. Keep me quiet when you want me silent. Lord, I want to obey the Spirit of God. I cannot preach without you. I need your touch, I need your help, I need your anointing, I need your power, I need the unction to function. We'll give you glory. We ask you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Now, I began to think about the book of John. I've been studying quite a bit out of four Gospels, Brother Jonathan. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Been praying that God would shed some light on some familiar passages of Scripture and just open my heart to some things that He would. You know, not only do I want the Lord to grow me, that I can maybe help grow you as a pastor, but I just want Him to grow, Brother Mike. I want to grow as a Christian in the Lord. And so I began to think, and if you go to John chapter number 1, for instance, in John's prologue, he's kind of given an evangelistic talk, if you will, about the Lord. He's presenting Jesus and who He is. The Bible says in John 1, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God. Don't miss that. He said, in the beginning was the Word. That's Jesus. The Bible says in verse 14 that the Word became flesh. He said, so in the beginning there was God. How many believes that?
Amen.
In the beginning there was Jesus the Son, and in the beginning there was the Holy Spirit of God. All three are separate, but all three are one. I don't understand it all. I don't have to understand it all. I just believe it. Amen?
Amen.
And we shouldn't have to try to explain it away or whatever. Just believe it. Amen? So the Lord is presenting us Jesus. And the Bible says, in the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God, and the Word was The same was in the beginning with God. And then he said this, and I'm going to come back to this if God will bring me back to it. And all things were made by him. I'll underline that. And without him was not anything made that was made. So John said, I just want you to know that, let me give you a verse. I'm going to start out slow and then we're going to kick it in fifth gear. In John chapter number 20, at verse number 31, I'm going to share a verse with you that the Lord has just put on my heart. Look what John said in John 20, verse 31. But these are written that ye might believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing ye might have life through his name. So John is presenting the Lord. He's letting us know why he's writing these things. That in the beginning was the Word was with God, the Word was God. And that he was, verse number 4, he was light. Verse number 5, that he was light. That he is Savior. That he is Messiah. That he is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. That he's able to do exceeding and abundantly above all that we've asked to thank. And John, in chapter 1, he said the reason, the reason that I wrote these things is so that you might believe upon the Lord and let him change your life forever. I'm glad that we have the written word of God. I'm glad these things are penned down. I'm glad one day that God sent a preacher my way and he preached the word of God. And I'm glad that faith cometh by hearing and hearing the word of God. And I'm glad that all of the accounts of the Lord are penned down in this scripture that so, he gives you the presentation of the Lord. In John chapter number 2, at verse 1, through John chapter number 12, you're going to have the recorded public ministry of the Lord. In John 13, through John 17, there's the private ministry of the Lord. That's when he's in the upper room with his disciples. Then chapter 19, 20, 21, that is the crucifixion, the death, the burial, the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. John pins down several miracles of the Lord. For instance, in John chapter number 2, first miracle, turning the water into wine. And in John chapter number 4, the Bible says that a nobleman comes before the Lord and tells him that his son's dead, and the Lord sends him on his way and tells him that his son's going to live. That's a second miracle. In John chapter number 5, there's the man that's been laid in the pool of Bethesda for 38 years. Jesus touches him. In John chapter number 6, you're going to see where Jesus feeds the 5,000. You're going to see the next miracle, Jesus walks upon the water. In John chapter number 11, Jesus comes to the stone of Lazarus, the tomb of Lazarus, calls him up from the dead. And now it says one thing to call somebody back from the dead, but it's another thing, isn't it, to be the one in the tomb that comes out from being dead. And that's Jesus. The last miracle that John records is that Jesus was resurrected. And then we also see another miracle is in John 21 where Jesus feeds his disciples. Gives them breakfast, tells them to come and dine there on the shore of Galilee. So I began to think about these miracles. I began to think about the things that John pinned down. John said in John 21, he said that even all the things that the Lord had done and had accomplished, all the miracles, said that the word I see that he's telling us about this first miracle. But sisters, there's more than the miracle of turning water into wine. And so by God's help, I'm going to rise. And right now I'm studying on Catholicism. I want to know a little bit more about it. I'm trying to win a Catholic family over to the Lord by God's help. And God's been dealing with the two sons and the daughter. If we just get Dad to bend a little bit, I can't get him to bend, but Jesus can.
That's right.
And so I've been studying about Catholicism, and I found it interesting that because Jesus appeared at the marriage of Cana, and because that Mary, the mother of Jesus, was there, they believe that marriage is now a sacrament. Now, there's a difference in graces. There's all kinds of graces. But I want to give you a common grace. A common grace, you can take a lost person and a saved person, and a lost person wakes up under the same sun. A lost person sees the same moon. A lost person can have health. A lost person can have bread. A lost person can be blessed with a good job and with money. A lost sprinkled at birth, and then your confirmation, and they line it up with taking the bread and the wine, and so they preach that marriage adds to justification, sanctification, and salvation. That's not true. I believe in marriage. I believe in it so much. I got married. Amen. And I'm glad that Jesus was at our wedding, and I'm glad He's in our marriage, but guess what? Marriage did not save me. Now, I'm going to tell you, no sacrament saves you. Communion will not save you. Sprinkling will not save you. Baptism will not save you. Foot washing will not save you. Paying your tithes will not save you. Reading your Bible alone will not save you.
Whatever He does, the Bible
heaven. But I believe Mary had confidence in herself. There's been times Mama has come to me not as her son, but as her pastor, and said, I just need some advice. Now, I guarantee that in those 30 years before Jesus comes to the marriage of Cana, I bet there's been some times that Mary has come to him, her son, and asked him advice and asked him questions. I mean, he does all things perfect. He does all things well. He doesn't make any mistakes. He's got all knowledge. I mean, who better to go to advice than Jesus? And so wash it in the water pot. He said, if your body needed cleansing, you would be washed with the water from the water pot. He said that that water was not just used for the purification of oneself. He said it was used for the purification of the wine. He said you wouldn't want wine that he said you can drink the water. The water not would have some kind of bacteria in it. And if you drink the water, it'd kill it. And he said, but the wine, he said, you drink all that wine all gonna get drunk, and he said, being drunk in the sight of God to the Jews is sin. So he said, what they do is they take the strong wine, and it would be like diluting something. He said, they take a little bit of the strong wine and a little bit of the water, and they put the water with the wine, and it was used for purification. I thought, well, that's pretty interesting. Now, I didn't get any spiritual application from that at first. I thought, that's interesting. I've never heard that in my life. And so I began to think about this wedding party and all the people that were there. And Brother Rodney, because they ran out of wine, that the bridegroom, the host of this ceremony, would be looked down upon. The people in the community would probably make fun from that time on, saying, this is the guy that has invited us to a ceremony and they could not provide, could not supply. Inviting you all to a chicken dinner and saying, oh, we're going to have some fried chicken, and you come over to the house and you're excited about some fried chicken, and all we've got to offer is mashed potatoes and gravy, coleslaw and a biscuit, and you say, where's the chicken? You've invited us to a chicken dinner and you got no chicken. I think we can all relate to that. Another thing that we can relate to, how many is going to, now, if I'm going to invite you over to my house, right now, we've got some Little Caesar's pizza that's been in the refrigerator for 3 or 4 days. And if I invite you over to my house for dinner, I'm not going to get in the refrigerator, Brother Floyd, and give you a piece of that stale pizza. We're going to try our best to either cook you a good meal, a fresh meal, or present you with some. But you're not going to invite somebody over and give them leftovers, are you? You're going to give them the best. And so that's what this man said. He said, most people give the best, but you save the best for last. I'm going to come back to that here in just a moment. I'm going to give you two other thoughts that God has given me. Johnson's his uncle. Said, why don't Randy's not home? Said, they take me to Papa Bill's house. Said, take me to Preacher Nick's house. Take me. I mean, that boy's surrounded by preachers. I'm his uncle, Preacher Bill Greer's his great granddaddy. Randy Johnson's his great uncle. Nick Combox's his youth preacher. Ray Combox's his pastor. And he said, all I know is I got to go somewhere and ask Jesus into my heart. Listen, who else are you going to go to? But Jesus, he knew where to go. Hey, who's got the answer to your problems? Who's got the supply for you? Who can make you? I don't know any other place, Brother Rodney, there to go but Jesus. I don't know any other person but Jesus. Any other place but his being. I'm glad that Jesus, he is the way. He's the right way. He's got the answer. Hallelujah. Mary knew who to go to. I'm glad I know who to go to.
Amen.
Amen. I didn't have all that to do. They got me fired up at the nursing home this morning. I told them to pray for y'all that I'd almost preach no quit. Let me give you a few more thoughts that I've had. There's six water pots. Sister Patsy, I thought about why six water pots. Now, I'm going to look to these wiser preachers. I'm not real good at math, but I looked at it front and backwards and sideways and upside down and in and out. Diagonal, horizontal, and whatever it is. And I looked at chapter number 2, chapter number 3, chapter number 4. And the only thing that I can find at this time is that the Lord is called by disciples. And you'll see that in chapter number 1, around verse 36 on. There's Andrew and Philip and Bartholomew. I mean, they've got 5 disciples. So at first I thought, well, 6 water pots, maybe 1 Christian disciple and 1 for Jesus. Then I see something. I was reading and I thought about the 6 water pots and 6 being the number of man. And the Lord said, take these water pots. Now we're talking 20, 30 firkins. We're talking 20 to 30 gallons of water in these big stone pots. And see, the Jews of that day, they did not believe in being washed by a clay pot. It had to be stone. And the Lord tells them to fill it up. And the Bible says that they filled it up to the brim. Brother Tosh, I read that over. Now, you take, let's say this is a pot. Let's say this is a cup.
Oh, Lord.
I made y'all nervous. Let's say that. Let's say this is a big stump. And let's say, pray that I'm getting this out. I'm feeling it. I knew what I was going to say when I went to bed last night. Now, if somebody gave me a ball and said, preacher, can you fill that up? I'm going to fill it up, maybe right there. If I go somewhere and they say, sir, would you like more coffee? Rachel, they don't fill it up to the brim. Sometimes they have, and you spill it. But they spill it a little bit. But they fill it up to the brim. Now, Dalton, if I filled this up to the brim, now, there's still a little room in there, would you agree? It's not to the brim yet. The brim is the rim. And if I filled that up to the brim, that means there's no more room left. I believe with all my heart that there's a picture there. Jesus wants to fill you up. Not halfway, not 75% of the way. He wants to fill you up to the brim. Now, how many is filled up this morning? Now, have you got room left? Oh, you get filled up by Jesus, but there's still room for work, still room for money, still room for sports, still room for TV, still room for computer, still room for literature, still room for music. I mean, sometimes we can take what's left over and They filled it up to the brim. I was reading what, oh, Brother Jack, what's that preacher's name? M.R. Don. He wrote something in one of his books, and I meant to pin it down. And he said, Lord, help me to remember it right. M.R. Don, Dr. M.R. Don, brilliant man. He said, the conscience of the water blushed when the master stepped in front of it. Oh, God. Praise the Lord. Now you think about that. What does it take? I'm about, Brother Larry, I'm about to get Pentecostal. If I was going to make juice, Sister Helen, if I was going to make wine, well, first off, what I've got to do is I've got to take a vine. And then I've got to take the seed from that vine. And then I've got to plant the seed. And then that seed has to produce a vine. And then that vine grows. And then you've got to get the grape. And then you've got to take the grapes. And you've got to squash the grapes. And then you've got to take the juice. Listen, he didn't need a seed. He didn't need a vine. He didn't need a grape. He didn't need a tree. And praise the Lord. He didn't need no distillery, nothing like that. Oh, I'm telling you, the Bible says there was not anything made that was not made by him. I'm telling you, Jesus came to the water and he turned it into wine. He said it ain't fermented. You know, now listen, he said, you've come to the pot for cleansing. He said, I'm going to do more than the cleansing. When you look at water, for instance, there's three things that water represents in the Word of God. For instance, it's used for washing. The Bible says in Ephesians chapter number 5 and verse 26, by the washing of the Word. And so that's on the outside. When water is drunk, for instance, John chapter number 4, he said, once you get a taste of this water that I give, he said, there'll be a spring of life. There'll be a spring of living waters coming up out of your soul. And then also, not only does it represent washing, not only does it represent the Spirit of God, but it represents the world. For the Bible says in Revelation chapter number 17 that the great whore that was sitting upon the world said that these are sitting upon the water, said these are the people and the tongues and the nations. So the water represents spirit, and the water represents washing, and the water represents the world, the water that we go through, maybe go over, maybe go under, maybe go into. I thought about when God brought Moses out of Egypt and they went across the Red Sea. I'm glad one of these days, amen, I'm coming out of this world and I'm going to another world. Listen, right now, I'm glad that we're in America, and I know we got a government and they're making all these mistakes, but I'm telling you, I'm just a stranger here, Brother Ariel. I'm just a pilgrim. This world ain't my home. They look at me as peculiar, and when they were to be aliens, this world's really not our home. We're just here for a little while. But Brother Jared, one of these days, we're going to say goodbye to this world, and we're going to say hello in heaven. The Bible says my conversation's in heaven. I'm glad my name's written down in the book of life. In heaven, I'm glad I'm going to have an address in heaven. And guess what? One of these days, we're going to step out of this world into a new world.
Amen.
And Jesus, I believe by those water pumps, he was saying there ain't nothing in the water that can cleanse you. There ain't nothing in these pots that can change you. He said, it's what I do with what's in the pot that can change you.
Yeah.
It ain't the water in the tub that changes you. It's Jesus. It ain't the water. It's the blood. I believe that's what the significance of the water in the wine is. Now, I've got a lot more things that I can share, but I just want to say these. These ain't gonna be no good today. I can't even say the name. Look at verse number 10 with you. And then I'm going to try to close God with me. Praise the Lord. Let me tell you something else. I've just seen this in front of the top. Jesus said to them, fill the water pots with water, they filled them up to the brim, and he said to them, draw out now, and bear it to the governor. That's not the head waiter. And said, and they bear it. And when the ruler of the feast had tasted the water that was made wine, he knew not which it was, but the servants were. You know, this world don't know nothing about the Lord. They don't know. They don't know nothing about preaching, and nothing about prayer, and nothing about power. I mean, you know, right now we've got a young lady from Kentucky by the name of Kim Davis has been locked up because of her biblical belief, because she did not want to issue a license to the homosexual. I'm telling you, I'm just going to say it. I got a call the other day from a man. He said, if I came to your church and wanted you to marry me and my boyfriend, he said, would you do it? I said, I will not.
Amen. That's right.
Thank you.
I've got to get done. I've got to. Oh, I'm in overtime. Said, let me just put it in Old Nathan's language. Said, everybody gives the best first. And after everybody's had all they need, then we bring out we bring out second place. We bring out the leftovers. If you ate all our fried chicken and mashed potatoes and grits from KFC and you're still hungry, then we give you the still ones. Or we warm you up a can of raviolis. I love Chef Boy every day. It's good because he's a shade for you, Chef. I gotta make a little laugh because I've gotta get my bread. I'm gonna tell you, brother, right now, I've enjoyed this life. I've enjoyed this service. I've enjoyed the call Mary's put on my life. Don, I've enjoyed our marriage and I've enjoyed our family. Church, I've never been more satisfied in the ministry than I am right now. Brother Jack, if you only knew how honored I am to get to serve with you every week, brother. I'm telling you, the best thing is just hold on, church. Hey, see Jesus. Now, I'm trying to get done, brother Greg. Pray. Now, I don't read in that chapter, brother Don, where Jesus partook of the wine. He gave it to everybody else. Sister Brenda, the next time I see him at supper, he's in the upper room. And he said, I want to praise the Lord, sister. And they said, man, just breathe on me. He said, I'll not drink this wine again until I drink it anew with you in the Father's kingdom. I'm telling you, sit down, hallelujah. Sister Alicia, it's good here, but it's even better over there. The rest is yet to come. Glory, glory, glory. The rest is yet to come.
I think I'm sign.
I'm done.
You too.
Lord, help. A message yet to come. Have you ever heard the story about keep your fork because a message yet to come? Just keep your fork, church. Message yet to come. Amen. Can I tell you one more, Brother Taz, and then I'm going to quit. God bless you. He's filled me up. Boy, he's filled me up this morning. I'll never forget. Dear Santa God, unicorn. Sister Daisy Hall. She had to talk. Sister Carolyn, 3 weeks. She's at the point that she gave her to die.
Well,
I went to her house. And Rachel has, I mean, she couldn't see hardly. She said, couldn't talk. Sister Mimi didn't know she could. Sister Stephanie, I'm out there. I mean, I've been over there every day, sis, for 3 weeks. I held her hand. And then she looked. Couldn't communicate, no talk. I said, sis, will you hear me? Squeeze my hand. What squeeze my hand there? Listen. The edge. Garden comes and preach about to get over Daisy's hands. Says she's a talker. She wants to see the preacher. Sister Angie, she, her body was ridden away. I went in there and I got down and I said, Sister David, I said, it's preacher. I said, how you doing, honey? She said, preacher, if it gets any better, I won't be able to stand. And she closed her eyes. I believe she's saying, it's been good here, but all down with Old Yonder. Yes, it should.
Glory, glory, glory. I'm here. I'm going to ask Brother Jimmy to pray for invitation. Brother Jack's here. My good preacher buddy, Brother Bill's here. I'm going to beg the Lord, if you just need a little extra few dubs, just hope you get there. Just come. If you just need it,
charge for tonight.